Hello guys, and welcome back to my channel for something slightly different today. In today's video, I will be running over my Premier League predictions for the 2020-2021 season. I'm going to cover each team in slightly different depth, but work my way through from the bottom to the top of the table, and we will see who I think is going to get relegated, who I think is going to be in those European spots, and who ultimately is going to be lifting the Premier League trophy at the end of the season. So without any further ado, let's get into things and let's start with the three teams that I believe are going to get relegated. Okay then guys, kicking things off, and the team that I think will finish bottom of the Premier League in this upcoming season is West Bromwich Albion. Baggies fans are going to be unhappy with me for this, but I just don't think they have what it takes at either end of the field to cut it in the Premier League. Obviously, they're going to be buoyed by the signings of Matias Pereira and Grady Diangano, who they had on loan last season. They will really help. I hear good things about Pereira. I didn't watch a lot of West Brom football last season. But personally, I don't think Slaven Bilic has got anything at either end of the field that's really going to set them apart and be difference makers, really. Obviously, I'm aware that they've signed Cedric Kipri from Wigan, who I believe is a very good defender, but he's never played in the Premier League to my knowledge, so he could be an interesting addition, but again, I just don't think they have it. The main issue that I have with West Brom is their lack of firepower. They've got a striker pool to choose from of Charlie Austin, Hal Robson-Kanu and Kenneth Zahor, and I just don't think any of those are good enough to be a really prolific striker in the Premier League. Obviously, they do have something that I do value in terms of a very good manager. I think Slaven Bilic is a very good manager, but I sadly have West Brom being relegated bottom of the Premier League. Okay then guys, up next and finishing in 19th, I have West Ham. I really think this is going to be a tough season for the Hammers and a tough season for David Moyes, who I don't think will be their manager much past Christmas. You have the catch 22 at West Ham. If you've got ambitious owners and supporters, I think the supporters are fantastic. Obviously, they're expecting a lot. However, I just don't think they've got what it takes to secure it. I think avoiding relegation would be a very good season for West Ham and David Moyes, but I just don't see it personally. Obviously, you've got really ambitious owners, and they're not really, in terms of bringing people in, doing the right things. Obviously, I mentioned in my last, the last club that I mentioned, West Brom, they've let go Grady Diangana to West Brom, which has caused an unbelievable amount of outrage that I've seen online from the West Ham supporters, who expect them to keep hold of their talented youngsters rather than let them go to what is ultimately going to be a relegation candidate and a main rival in the season. I like the purchases of Susek and Jarrod Bowen from Hull. I think Jarrod Bowen's a really good player. I think he could get some really good minutes and good goals in for West Ham, but when I look at their strike force again, I'm not fully convinced in Sebastian Haller, who they spent a large chunk of money on last summer. He was in my fantasy Premier League draft all season and he was dreadful. So it's going to be a difficult one again for West Ham. In terms of players that they brought in, obviously I've mentioned Susek, who they signed from Slava Prague, but again, to this point, at the time of recording, they haven't filled me with enough confidence that they're going to do anything other than get relegated this season. Up next, we have the second of the three promoted teams from the Championship, and that is Scott Parker's Fulham. Obviously, Fulham 2 seasons ago got promoted to the Premier League and were the first promoted club to spend over £100 million in that transfer window, signing 12 players. They're going to be doing things slightly differently this summer. Obviously, they've brought in a couple of additions. Anthony Robinson from Wigan, Lamina from Southampton. Again, I think that's a good sign-in. The main one for me is Alfonso Areola, who they brought in from Real Madrid. Is he still at Real Madrid or is he a PSG player? I don't know. They brought him in on loan. I can't remember what club he's coming in from. I think that's a very good, astute signing. I think he's a very good goalkeeper, a little bit underrated. So I think he will actually win them a decent amount of points this season just on his own. However, I just don't think it will be enough. I think they will perform a lot better than teams like West Brom, for instance. I think they've definitely equipped themselves quite nicely. There's a couple of players in there that I do like. Obviously, I am a Bristol City fan. So Joe Bryan in the team and Bobby Reed, again, good players, even though Bobby's probably not going to be their starting choice player up front. Obviously, they do have a Premier League striker in Mitrovic, which I don't think the other two clubs that I've mentioned so far have. I think Mitrovic, whilst he is prone to the occasional red card, he will score between 5 and 10 goals for them at the very least this season, which is something that I think they need. Obviously, they were very leaky at the end of they were very leaky in their last stint in the Premier League. They conceded a lot of goals, and hopefully the addition of Areola and Kenny Tete, who they've signed from Lyon, will be good enough to shore up that potential leaky defence. Obviously, some of the players that they did sign, like Joe Bryan, for instance, when they went into the Premier League last time, have had two more years to sort of like develop as a player. So I'm hoping that they can have a good season, although I do feel that they will it's going to be close. I think they will get relegated, but I think it's going to be towards the end of the season, if not the final day. Okay, so narrowly missing out on relegation in 17th, I have Aston Villa. I think that the main reasons I'm basically saying that I think Aston Villa will stay up and the three teams I've mentioned so far won't, is basically because of Jack Grealish. I think he's a superb player. Obviously, getting his first England appearance will help him no end, I think. Obviously, the additions of Matty Cash from Nottingham Forest and a big spend on Ollie Watkins from Brentford will help as well. But I think the main player for them is Jack Grealish. He is their talisman. He is that main man that they look to. I think Villa are okay. It's a tough one. There's a couple of teams that I fancied to get relegated. Villa were one of them, but obviously the addition of Ollie Watkins, who I think is a superb striker. His first season in the Premier League, he's going to want to prove himself. I think he is going to be a good hit this season. So if you are playing fantasy Premier League, I think Ollie Watkins will come in at a relatively cheap price. And I think he could get a couple of goals. I think it's something that Villa have been lacking in terms of a striker. Obviously, they create a lot of chances, but hopefully Ollie Watkins can be the person to keep them in the Premier League this season, especially if they spent so much money on him. Next up, we have Crystal Palace, who I think will have a really tough season, but I think they have individual quality that, if they can keep everybody fit, will make the difference. Obviously, Palace had potentially, I think it was the worst record since lockdown was over and coming back into Premier League football. They've made some interesting additions, most notably Eze from QPR, and obviously yesterday they signed Michy Batshuayi on loan from Chelsea, who I think will be a very, very good addition for Palace. That front three of Batshuayi, Eze and Wilfried Zaha, of course, will cause teams problems in the Premier League. I think it's going to be an interesting one for Palace. Obviously, they need to turn around that lockdown form and hit the ground running, and I hope Michy Batshuayi can get some good game time at Palace. I think he's a very, very good striker, but needs a little bit more game time in the Premier League. Next up, we have Southampton. I don't think they will be doing as well throughout the course of this season as they did after lockdown. Only the two Manchester clubs earned more points than Southampton after the restart, with Southampton recording 5 wins and just 1 defeat in their 9 fixtures behind closed doors since lockdown. They had a very good record and they finished 11th in the Premier League last season. I don't think they will be sucked into a relegation battle. The addition of Kyle Walker-Peters is an interesting one, as well as a guy from Real Valladolid, who I don't actually know a great deal of. It looks like they've cleared out a decent amount of players as well. Yoshida's been released. Obviously, Hoiberg's gone to Spurs. Cedric has gone to Arsenal. Lamina to Fulham on loan. They've cleared out an interesting set of players. And obviously, the new Southampton manager, whose name I cannot even attempt to pronounce. I think it's Ralf Hasenhüttl. Sure, let's go for that. I think he's trying to put more of his own stamp on it now. I think, you know, as I said, they had a very good end to the season, and Danny Ings is going to be their key man if they can keep Danny Ings fit. He is a proven Premier League goal scorer, and I think he can score goals in the Premier League still. But hopefully they show more of the form that they did since lockdown rather than the form that they showed before lockdown, obviously including the 9-0 hammering by Leicester City. Going to be an interesting one for Southampton. If they can keep that post-lockdown form going, they could be a real threat and maybe push into the top half of the table. I personally don't see it. I think there are several better teams than them in the Premier League, even outside of the top seven. I still think there are teams that are more well-equipped than Southampton, but I think they will have a potentially positive season. Next, we have another team from the South Coast, as I feel Brighton will finish next in the table. They were very easy on the eye last season, whilst still struggling and just sort of staying above that relegation zone. I think they've added some interesting players. Adam Lallana's a great player if they can keep him fit. Joel Veltman from Ajax, again, will help shore up that defence. It's one of those where I think Brighton had... like it was like fine lines deciding their games last season. A game against Palace where they lost at home sort of really does stick in the mind. Where they lost 1-0 at home, they were the better side, absolutely dominated Palace all game. But didn't manage to get the job done. I personally really like Neil Maupay as well, the former Brentford man. I think he's a very good striker, can score a lot of goals. Can score a lot of goals in the Premier League. I think he proved that last season that he can score goals. So fingers crossed that he has a good season, and I'd like to see Adam Lallana have a full season at a club. Obviously, his time towards the end at Liverpool, Jurgen Klopp was kind of nursing him, making sure that he was able to get a deal somewhere, and I'd like to see him again on a football pitch, because I think he's a very classy player and could make all the difference for Brighton, especially, as I said, fine lines last season. They did manage to stay up. Hopefully they can build on that. Up next is Sheffield United. I think whilst they spent a large portion of last season in the hunt for European football only to fall away just at the death, I think Chris Wilder's men are going to have a little bit of a drop off this season. I think whilst they did finish so high last season, I just don't think they can replicate that this season. I'm a massive admirer of Wilder. Have been since he was Northampton boss and I was working at Bristol Rovers. I think he's a great manager. I think he's going to do unbelievable things for the club. But I just think that this season, instead of looking up and trying to qualify for a European competition, I think they just need a season of consolidation. They've brought in some interesting players. Most notably for me is Ethan Ampadu, who they brought in on loan from Chelsea. And I really think he could be a difference. Obviously, he's been on loan previously at RB Leipzig. Didn't really play, so I'm hoping that he does get some game time, the young Welshman. But yeah, I just think this is going to be a season for Sheffield United that it's going to be a mixed bag. I just don't see them being as good as they were last season, but I obviously don't see them being sucked into a relegation battle. I just think they've got the mentality, they've got a really good manager, but I just think teams will slowly start to figure them out. I think towards the end of the season, they've had a Premier League teams would have had a full season analysing them, seeing how they get on against Premier League opposition. And I just think this season they will struggle a little bit more to keep as many clean sheets as they did. Obviously, defensively, they were superb last season. Obviously, they have brought in some additions in the wing-back positions. I can't remember their names now. Max Lowe and can't remember the other guy's name, the two fullbacks, give them options, give them rotation options as well, keep everybody fresh in those high intensity positions. But yeah, I just don't think that they will be as good as they were last season. So now we're into 12th position, and this is where I have Newcastle United. I think they've done some superb business, sort of picking the bones off of their Bournemouth side that got relegated. The additions of Callum Wilson and Ryan Fraser, I think, are superb. Having Fraser on one side, Saint-Maximin on the other, with Callum Wilson up front, Almiron in behind, I actually do think that's quite a good attacking lineup. They've also brought in Jamal Lewis from Norwich. I think they've done quite a good job in terms of bolstering the squad whilst it's not the massive money spending that everybody hoped that Newcastle would be, obviously with the failed takeover, I think they've made some very astute signings that will really help. Obviously, Joelinton, they spent a lot of money on Joelinton last season and he didn't really cut the mustard. And I think that bringing in someone of Callum Wilson's quality as Football Manager, fans up and down the country will know how good Callum Wilson can be. I think he will make a big difference. I like Fraser as well. I like Jamal Lewis. I think they're very good additions. And that is why I have Newcastle so high in this table. Okay, so rounding off the bottom half of the table, I have Burnley, who seem to be the sort of like the steady team who you can always rely on to put in a decent performance and do relatively well. They've achieved 2 top 10 finishes in 3 seasons, but that still doesn't mean that avoiding relegation is their first priority. Obviously, Sean Dyche is doing a fantastic job there, but their net spend of just £9 million in their time in the Premier League isn't what you are accustomed to, given all the TV revenues and stuff like that Premier League sides do get. There have been some recent examples of the wheels potentially falling off teams like this. Recent examples of that are, you know, Stoke with 3 straight 9th place finishes before they got relegated. And more recently, Watford, who finished 11th and there were FA Cup finalists before they got relegated themselves. Obviously, as I said, there are potential trends that Burnley could follow. I don't think they will. I think there'll be another safe mid-table side again for this season. But it is interesting to see those other teams and what's happened to them. I think their transfer business has been okay. I don't think it's been spectacular. But yeah, again, middle of the road team. I think Burnley will do okay. I don't think they'll be playing for anything towards the end of the season. So we move into the top half of the table, and the team that I have finishing in 10th is last season's winners of the championship, Leeds United. I really think Leeds are going to be a breath of fresh air this season. I love Bielsa. I love the style that he tries to play. And I think that they are going to cause a lot of teams a lot of trouble this season. Obviously, Leeds is a very intimidating atmosphere to go to. I think the fans are going to be superb all season. It's actually going to be refreshing to see Leeds United back in the Premier League, having been out of it for so long. When they played Arsenal back in the FA Cups in January, it was a game that I watched, and Leeds were just by far the better side, in my opinion. Superb passing of the ball, and I think their additions this season have been breathtaking. Obviously, they've brought in Jack Harrison again on loan from Manchester City, but the one that I'm looking at is Rodrigo from Valencia. I think whilst he didn't score a superb amount of goals last season, for Valencia, I think the difference in Premier League sides versus Spanish sides, I think he's going to be a hit this season. He's in my fantasy Premier League team, I will say. I do have Rodrigo from Leeds in my fantasy Premier League team. It's a little bit of a baptism of fire for Leeds away at Anfield in the first game of the season. But I think overall, I think Leeds will do quite well. As I said, I like the way that Bielsa sets his teams up, and I genuinely think Leeds will be a very big surprise package this season, and that is why I have them finishing in 10th. Moving up to 9th, and we have Leicester City. I think it's going to be a good one for Leicester. Obviously, they do have a prolific goal scorer in Jamie Vardy, although his time in the Premier League and into his time in football in general, I think, is slowly coming towards the end. Their over-reliance on him could be their downfall. Obviously, they've had a big high profile departure this summer with Ben Chilwell joining Chelsea. They have replaced him to an extent with Castagne, who they've signed from Atalanta. Previously was a winger from my memory, but is now more adopted as a left back. Be interesting to see how they get on, but obviously their over reliance on Jamie Vardy's goal scoring exploits is their kind of sticking point. He's a superb player, can score a lot of goals in the Premier League, obviously with golden boots in previous seasons. But for me, it's going to be, I just don't see Leicester like they were at the start of last season, sort of like battling it out at the top of the table. I think they will finish in the top half, and I think it will be comfortable. But I think there are much stronger teams in this Premier League this season, who I will go over very shortly. Now we move on to a team that I think has done superbly in this transfer window, and that is Everton. Obviously, Ancelotti is the boss at Everton, and they've brought in Alan, who I love, from Napoli. They brought in James Rodriguez from Real Madrid, and they brought in Doucouré from relegated Watford. Basically rebranded their midfield entirely. Obviously, they have exceptional talents like Richarlison. Dominic Calvert-Lewin, I think, is a very good player. Dinier, I think, is a good player as well, for the record. I think they've got a very good nucleus of a squad, and obviously the additions of those three really, really good midfielders, I think really will transform how Everton are trying to play football this season. I think they're going to be a real threat. I'm really intrigued to see James Rodriguez in the Premier League. Obviously, he's been dotting around on various loans for the past couple of years since signing for Real Madrid. But I think the additions of Doucouré and Alan, who will play sort of behind him, I think, means he can just sort of focus on moving forward. He doesn't really have to worry about any defensive duty because Alan will mop up everything. He is an unreal player. I was so shocked when Everton signed him for such a small fee. I can't even remember how much the fee was. Let me check, see if I can find it super quick. No. Yeah, I was just so surprised when Everton signed Alan. Obviously, he's played over 200 times for Napoli. He's made Brazilian appearances. He's played in the Champions League. I think he's just a superb addition to Everton. And I think Everton could, if all the signings click, could be a real team to watch this season. So as we move into the top seven, I have Wolves coming in seventh. I think they've done some superb business, obviously, with a whole nation as their feeder club of Portugal. I think they've done a really good job in bringing in some good players again. As I said, any Football Manager fans out there, they all know about Fabio Silva. Some people don't. I think in the long term, I think he's going to be fantastic. Obviously, he's going to be playing second fiddle to Jimenez at the moment, who is a very, very good goal scorer, proven commodity in the Premier League. I'm very interested to see how many minutes Fabio Silva actually does get. I know they've signed Marcão from Lyon and Vitinha from Porto again. Obviously, another Portuguese player coming in. I think that Wolves, again, will be one of those teams who are battling out for that European contention. As I said, I'm very interested to see how many minutes Fabio Silva gets. And I think the Portuguese infusion in Wolverhampton will be a very, very good watch this season. I'd love to see them finish up a little bit higher in the table, but I just think there are the next two teams that I've got battling out for those top four spots and those Europa League spots will do slightly better. Yeah, a very interesting watch of Wolves. I'm very much looking forward to seeing how they get on this season. Okay, so as we move into the top six, I have put Spurs here. For those of you guys who have been watching All or Nothing Tottenham Hotspur, I've been engaged in it totally. I love it. I love Jose. And I think they've made some decent additions this season. They brought in Højbjerg from Southampton. They brought in Joe Hart as a backup. I think he's a good backup for Hugo Lloris. Because if you guys are watching the same as me, if you've seen Gazzaniga in the All or Nothing Tottenham series, I feel that he's let them down quite a lot, especially whilst Lloris was out injured last season. It just seemed like the ball was flying past him left, right and centre. But their main addition for me is Matt Doherty, who they've signed from Wolves. I think he's a superb player. I think he fits the mentality that Mourinho is trying to get. I think he's going to be a very good addition, bombing up and down that left-hand side. Be interesting to see how they get on. Obviously, every season it seems that Harry Kane has an injury. So it'll be interesting to see how they potentially cope with that. Obviously, they signed Bergwijn last season in the January window, who could play up front. Obviously, they've got players like Dele Alli, Lucas Moura, and obviously Heung-Min Son, who are very, very good players in the Premier League. I like Tottenham a lot, but I don't think they will have enough to crack into that top four. I think some of the other teams in the Premier League have just strengthened so much better than them. I can't wait for another season of All or Nothing Tottenham, let's put it that way. So the team that I have finishing just outside of the top four is Mikel Arteta's Arsenal. I think he's really turned a corner with Arsenal, obviously winning the FA Cup last season, and winning the potentially most boring game of the year, the Community Shield against Liverpool. It really shows that I think they have turned a corner. Arteta is really putting his stamp on the team, and obviously towards the end of the season, I think they were playing quite well. Obviously, they brought in Dani Ceballos for another year. They've brought in Gabriel from Lille, Cedric from Southampton. And I think the one who will make a very big difference is Willian from Chelsea, obviously on that free transfer. Obviously, they've got Aubameyang. They've got Aubameyang, they've got Lacazette. Who knows what's happening to Mesut Ozil. They've also got a plethora of youth talent like Saka, Emile Smith-Rowe, Eddie Nketiah. And they've definitely got a lot of good attributes. I think they'll have a very good season. I think they will be battling it out for that top four spots. I think they will be there or thereabouts, but I think they will just miss out and will have to settle for Europa League football this next season. Now we move into the top four, and I am going to put Chelsea here. A slightly controversial decision. I think Chelsea have brought in some unbelievable signings in the likes of Timo Werner, Ziyech, Chilwell, Thiago Silva, although he's a bit old, and obviously most notably Kai Havertz, who they spent a lot of money on. These are superb signings. They really are. Honestly, I think Frank Lampard's done a good job bringing them in. I don't know whether it's they all really want to work with Frank Lampard or Chelsea are just paying them a lot. They are all very good signings. They've spent a lot of money this summer, Chelsea. I'll be very interested to see how they gel. Obviously, they have signed some very good attacking talent, obviously, to go alongside Pulisic and players like Tammy Abraham, Mason Mount, that sort of thing. So I definitely think they've bolstered their firepower. Although I didn't, that's kind of where their issue was. That wasn't where their issue was last season. They were conceding too many sloppy goals. As I mentioned, they have signed Thiago Silva on a free transfer from PSG. Is a 35-year-old going to make the difference in the Premier League? I don't know. I think he will allow movement around the team, as in, I think Azpilicueta will play right back now, which is a little bit more of a solid option. Tried and tested in the Premier League. But will he be the difference maker? Obviously, at the time of recording, they have not signed a goalkeeper. So Kepa will be their goalkeeper at the moment. Obviously, they have been linked with, I can't remember the name of the guy from Lille, but they've been linked with the Lille goalkeeper. If they bring him in, maybe. I don't know. I personally don't think Kepa's that bad of a goalkeeper. Every goalkeeper is prone to making some mistakes every now and again. And he is still young, so he could atone and make things right for Chelsea. But I think all their new signings will mean they will secure top four. I think they'll be in there. I think they'll be battling in and out of the top three this season, but I think they will just narrowly miss out to the team that I have in third. And the team that I do have in third is Manchester United. I think Ollie has turned a corner. I think Solskjaer really has turned a corner. I like the addition of Donny van de Beek for the midfield. I think he's a very good player. Obviously, they're going to have the likes of Rashford, Greenwood, Martial, Bruno Fernandes. If they can keep Paul Pogba fit, I think that'll be massive for them this season. But again, this is another team that I think is very top heavy. They've got a lot of forwards. Maybe they need to strengthen it, the back of the field. Obviously, David De Gea is having his issues at the moment, but I think he will be their number one goalkeeper moving into the season, which is unfortunate for Henderson. I'd love to see him go out on loan to a higher profile club than Sheffield United this season. I think for the sake of his England career, I think he needs that. But I don't see him getting an opportunity at Manchester United. As I said, I like the addition of Van de Beek. But I'm unsure at the moment as to how many minutes he's going to get. I see him being an impact sub / cup player for the first season, which is a shame because I think he's a superb talent. It would be really nice to see the Dutchman play. But Ollie's got a plethora of options in these attacking spots. And who knows, they may end up buying Jadon Sancho. I personally think they will. I think they'll just buckle and pay however much Dortmund want, which I believe is rumoured to be 110 million. I think they will buckle and I think they will pay it. But at the time of recording, they haven't. So I think they will finish in third. I think they will have a very, very good season. Obviously, the penalty king, Bruno Fernandes, is going to be flying again this season, I think. But they will miss out on the top two spots. Let's get into the top two spots. So we move into the top two of the Premier League. And it's a slightly controversial choice, I think. I have Manchester City in second. Missing out on the title last season, obviously, through Liverpool's superb dominance. And I think they will do it again. I think they will finish second. Some interesting additions in Ferran Torres and Nathan Ake. I think they're very good players. Torres doing very, very good work at Valencia last season. And Nathan Ake, again, is a young ball-playing centre-back that fits Pep's style at Man City. As I said, they missed out last season. I think David Silva will be a loss regardless of how good Phil Foden is. And I think Phil Foden will have a very good season and bounce back from his ban from the English national team for his incident in Iceland. I just don't think... I think Liverpool have got them mentally at the moment. Personally, I think they'll have a very good season. I think they'll go very far and maybe pick up a trophy or two along the way. But I just don't think the Premier League will be that trophy. They've got options, obviously, Bernardo Silva, Ferran Torres now, Sterling. I've put Man City second. I think they'll score more goals than Liverpool, but I just don't think they'll get as many points. Obviously, they've been linked with Lionel Messi all summer. And obviously, that seems to be not happening now. He said he's going to stay at Barcelona. I think that it's going to be a superb season for Man City. I think they're going to score an unbelievable amount of goals, but I just don't think it's going to be enough for them. So that does mean that I have Liverpool topping the table and retaining the Premier League trophy for another season. And they've not really made any superb additions to their team, but I just think their team is just so, so good. I just think that they'll be able to hold on and just do what they did last season, just grind out games, not necessarily scoring as many goals as Man City, not necessarily being anywhere near as flashy. But I just think they just get the job done. I think Klopp's got them playing superb football, playing the way that he wants. I think Salah and Mane are going to have a superb season. I'd love to see them keep hold of Gini Wijnaldum. I think he's an unbelievable player, very underrated in that Liverpool team. Obviously, he has been rumoured to go to Barcelona. We'll see if that does transpire towards the end of the window. And they've obviously been linked with Thiago coming in from Bayern Munich. Obviously, I think that would be a replacement. They've let a couple of the interesting players go. Nathaniel Klein's gone, Dejan Lovren's gone, Lallana's gone. So they've cleared out a little bit of deadwood. So there is some salary room in there. And I just think Liverpool will be too strong for the rest of the Premier League in the 2020-21 season. So that is my Premier League predictions, guys. I've gone through 20th to 1st with Liverpool retaining the Premier League title. If you disagree with me, I'm sure you will. I'm sure there'll be some supporters out there who are baffled by my selections, but this is kind of what I think is going to happen this season. If you do disagree, let me know in the comment section. I will be in that comment section as soon as this video goes live to speak to you guys and let me know where you think everyone will be, where you agree, where you disagree. If you think Man City are going to lift the title, if you think West Ham are going to stay up. I personally don't. It'll be interesting to see what you guys think. If you have enjoyed the video and you do agree with these predictions, don't forget to drop a like on the video. It really does help the video get out there to as many people as possible. And if you are new to the channel, welcome. And if you could hit that subscribe button for more Football Manager content that I will be bringing you on a daily basis. This is a kind of bonus video. As we are about to start the Premier League season, that would be fantastic. But that is it for today's video, guys. If you have enjoyed it, as I said, don't forget to drop a like down below and subscribe to the channel. But for now, guys, take care and I'll see you soon.